Please stand. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. And as we gather for this Eucharist, let's come acknowledging our sins, recognizing these great sacred mysteries that we are about to celebrate, and let's ask God for mercy. I confess to Almighty God, and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and in what I have failed to do, through my most grievous fault. Therefore, I ask, Blessed Mary, ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and to you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Amen. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Let us pray. Set aside, O Lord, the bond of sentence written for us by the law of sin, which in the Paschal mystery you cancelled through the resurrection of Christ your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. About this time, when the number of disciples were increasing, the Hellenists made a complaint against the Hebrews. In the daily distribution, their own widows were being overlooked. So the 12 called a full meeting of the disciples and addressed them. It would not be right for us to neglect the word of God so as to give out food. You, brothers, must select from among yourselves 7 men of good reputation, filled with the Holy Spirit and with wisdom. We will hand over this duty to them and continue to devote ourselves to prayer and to the service of the word. The whole assembly approved of this proposal and elected Stephen, a man full of faith and of the Holy Spirit, together with Philip, Prochorus, Nicanor, Timon, Parmenas, and Nicholas of Antioch, a convert to Judaism. They presented these to the apostles, who prayed and laid their hands on them. The word of the Lord continued to spread. The number of disciples in Jerusalem was greatly increased, and a large group of priests made their submission to the faith. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Lord, let your mercy be on us as we place our trust in you.
Lord, let your mercy be on us as we place our trust in you.
Ring out your joy to the Lord, O you just, for praise is fitting for loyal hearts. Give thanks to the Lord upon the harp. With a 10-string lute, sing him songs.
Lord, let your mercy be on us as we place our trust in you.
For the word of the Lord is faithful, and all his works to be trusted. The Lord loves justice and right, and fills the earth with his love.
Lord, let your mercy be on us as we place our trust in you.
The Lord looks on those who revere him, on those who hope in his love, to rescue their souls from death, to keep them alive in famine.
Lord, let your mercy be on us as we place our trust in you.
Alleluia, alleluia. Christ is risen, the Lord of all creation. He has shown pity on all people. Alleluia.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John.
Glory to you, O Lord.
In the evening, the disciples went down to the shore of the lake and got into a boat to make for Capernaum on the other side of the lake. It was getting dark by now, and Jesus had still not rejoined them. The wind was strong and the sea was getting rough. They had rowed 3 or 4 miles when they saw Jesus walking on the lake and coming towards the boat. This frightened them, but he said, "It is I. Do not be afraid." They were for taking him into the boat, but in no time it reached the shore at the place they were making for. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus was not recognized by the apostles as they saw him walking on the water. In fact, they've been living with him, they've seen him do all the miracles, they've heard him preach, and yet they did not recognize him. But the situation where it is that it says that they were on the boat moving to Capernaum, going across the Sea of Galilee, and the waves were strong, the boat must have been bashed with waves and water, and they were so caught up in that storm that even when Jesus came, they did not recognize him. And I think that's so much what happens to us too, that we could be faithful, we could be coming to Mass regularly, we could be having a deep prayer life, but yet when the storms hit, what do? Do we recognize Jesus coming to us at those times and meeting us, or are we caught up with fear? And that's why Jesus speaks those words and he says, "It is I, do not be afraid." And most often it's in our struggles and our difficulties that's when Jesus actually comes so much more to walk with us and to carry us in his arms rather than we ever having to battle it ourselves. But the question is whether we recognize him or not. And God can come to us in many ways. There's a story told of a flood that hit a particular city, and all the houses were almost submerged in the water. And one man got onto his roof, and he was sitting on his roof, and he was a faithful man, and he cried out, "Lord, I know that you're a God who's alive, that you will come in and save me." And just as he made his prayer, there was a man kind of riding past and going in a canoe, and he said, come on, you're going to be drowned, come and join me." And he said, no, you carry on, God is going to save me." A little after that, there was a boat that came by. The man from the boat shouted out and said, "Come on to the boat." And he said, no, you just carry on, God's going to save me." And then an helicopter came, and the man from the helicopter also shouted out and put out a rope saying, "Come on, you have to get out, otherwise you're going to be drowned." And then again, he said, "No, don't worry, God is going to save me." He had such a strong faith. But then a little later, the waters rose, he died, he went up to heaven, he looked at St. Peter and he said, how come I had my faith so much and God did not come to save me? He said, what? God sent you a canoe, God sent you a boat, God sent you an helicopter, and yet you didn't respond? How else is he going to save you? And I think that's what you and I miss, that in our practical situations of life, God comes to us in such beautiful ways, but we have our own notion and understanding or perception of how God needs to save me, and sometimes you could get so fixated with that. God is moving and working so powerfully in our lives, and that's what we are celebrating now, that he's resurrected, he's alive. Do we recognize him working in each one of our lives every day, every moment, and seeing him alive in our midst? And he wants to speak to you like he spoke to the apostles. It is I, do not be afraid. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received this bread we offer you, fruit of the earth and work of human hands. It'll become for us the bread of life. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received this wine we offer you, fruit of the vine and work of human hands. It'll become for us our spiritual drink. Pray, sisters and brothers, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. O God, who will that through the sanctify graciously these gifts, O Lord, we pray, and accepting the oblation of this spiritual sacrifice, make of us an eternal offering to you, through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts, and let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation at all times to acclaim you, O Lord, but in this time above all to laud you yet more gloriously when Christ our Passover has been sacrificed. Through him the children of light rise to eternal life, and the halls of the heavenly kingdom are thrown open to the faithful. For his death is our ransom from death, and in his rising the life of all has risen. Therefore, overcome with paschal joy, every land, every people exults in your praise, and even the heavenly powers with the angelic hosts sing together the unending hymn of your praise as we acclaim. Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and as he entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and giving thanks, he broke it and he gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, and Anthony, our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Amen. At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, let us dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you." Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Let us offer each other the sign of peace.
Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, grant us peace. Behold, this is Jesus, the Lamb of God. He takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are we who are called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I'm not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. Let us pray. We have partaken of the gifts of this sacred mystery, humbly imploring, O Lord, that what your Son commanded us to do in memory of him may bring us growth in charity. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Go in peace, glorifying the Lord by your life.
Thanks be to God.
archangel. Defend us in battle. Be our safeguard against the wickedness and snares of the devil. May God rebuke him, we humbly pray. And do thou, Prince of the heavenly host, by the power of God, cast into hell Satan and all the evil spirits who prowl about the world, seeking the ruin of souls. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The Lord be with you. We pray for all parishioners, relatives, friends, medical professionals, volunteers, for the sick. We join on Sol Cruz in thanking God for graces received, and we pray for all our faithful departed, especially John, Lucy and John Teixeira. To prepare ourselves, let us again be truly sorry for our sins and ask the Lord for pardon and strength. I confess, Almighty God, and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and in what I have failed to do. Through my most grievous fault. Therefore I ask the Blessed Mary, ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Let us pray. O God, hope and light of the sincere, we humbly entreat you to dispose our hearts to offer you worthy prayer and ever to extol you by dutiful proclamation of your praise. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. The apostles were being questioned by the high priest before the council. But a Pharisee in the council named Gamaliel, a teacher of the law, respected by all the people, stood up and ordered the apostles to be put outside for a short time. Then he said to the members of the council, "Fellow Israelites, consider carefully what you propose to do to these men. For some time ago, Theudas rose up, claiming to be somebody, and a number of men, about 400, joined him, but he was killed, and all who followed him were dispersed and disappeared. After him, Judas the Galilean rose up at the name of the census and got people to follow him. He also perished, and all who followed him were scattered. So in the present case, I tell you, keep away from these men and let them alone. Because if this plan or this undertaking is of human origin, it will fail. But if it is of God, you will not be able to overthrow them. In that case, you may even be found fighting against God." They were convinced by him, and when they had called in the apostles, they had them flogged. Then they ordered them not to speak in the name of Jesus and let them go. As they left the council, the apostles rejoiced that they were considered worthy to suffer dishonor for the sake of the name. And every day in the temple and at home, they did not cease to teach and proclaim Jesus as the Messiah. The word of the Lord. One thing I seek, to dwell in the house of the Lord. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? One thing I ask of the Lord, that will I seek, to live in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord, and to inquire in his temple. I believe that I shall see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Wait for the Lord, be strong, and let your heart take courage. Wait for the Lord. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. No one lives on bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of God.
The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. Jesus went to the other side of the Sea of Galilee, also called the Sea of Tiberias. A large crowd kept following him because they saw the signs that he was doing for the sick. Jesus went up the mountain and sat down there with his disciples. Now the Passover, the festival of the Jews, was near. When he looked up and saw a large crowd coming toward him, Jesus said to Philip, "Where are we to buy bread for these people to eat?" He said this to test him, for he himself knew what he was going to do. Philip answered him, 6 months' wages would not buy enough bread, for each one of them got a little. One of his disciples, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, said to him, "There is a boy here who has 5 barley loaves and 2 fish. But what are they among so many people?" Jesus said, "Make the people sit down." Now there was a great deal of grass in the place, so they sat down, about 5,000 in all. Then Jesus took the loaves, and when he had given thanks, he distributed them to those who were seated, so also the fish, as much as they wanted. When they were satisfied, he told his disciples, "Gather up the fragments left over, so that nothing may be lost." So they gathered them up, and from the fragments of the 5 barley loaves left by those who had eaten, they filled 12 baskets. When the people saw the sign that he had done, they began to say, "This is indeed the prophet who is to come into the world." When Jesus realized that they were about to come and take him by force to make him king,
he withdrew again to the mountain by himself. The Gospel of the Lord. When I was a young boy, at home, sometimes, you know, we live very busy lives, and we do not eat together at the dinner table. And I remember one time when my grandmother said to all of us, you know, we should try to eat at the same time, not eat, you know, one and then the other will eat later, no? We should strive to eat together. And the reason that my grandmother mentioned this is because if you eat by yourself, not waiting for the rest of the family to eat with you, chances are the food that was cooked would not be enough. You know, would not be enough. But if you eat together at the same time, you will notice that there will still be a lot left over. Do you agree? Is that also your experience? And I think that if we have to apply the gospel reading in our context today, it would be something like what I have just described to you. If we only satisfy our very selves at the exclusion of the others, then there is going to be much need. And others will just go hungry. But if we learn to share, then everybody will be fed. I think personally that would be a miracle in itself. You know, I got into trouble one day with this gospel because when I mentioned about the example of that little boy, you know, children are very they're very spontaneous than their elders. When they have something, oftentimes they would share what they have, I think. At least that's my experience with children. They do not hesitate to share what they have. And better, I think, than most adults do. So it's not surprising that Philip would say to Jesus, Andrew would say to Jesus, you know, there is this boy here who has 5 barley loaves and 2 fish. I suspect that this boy approached Andrew. It was getting to the noon hour, and, it's time to eat. And maybe this young boy approached Andrew and says, you know, I have something that my mother gave me to eat for lunch. Would you like to share it with me? And that is probably the reason why when Jesus presented that problem to the disciples, Andrew stepped forward and said, there is this boy who has 5 barley loaves and 2 fish. And then from that meager portion, our Lord used to perform this miracle where, 6,000 people were fed that day. Could it be possible, and this is where I got into trouble one day, because I raised that question, would it be possible, or could it be possible, that when people saw the example of that little boy, they were quickened to the heart, and they started to share what they have with one another. And as a result, many were fed that day. But of course, in our imagination, we would rather prefer, you know, to see Jesus really as the wonder worker, you know, when he takes the bread and says the blessing, and then voila, you know, the bread got multiplied. So what do you think? What would do you think was the that the Lord did, you know, and how that may apply in our context today? If only we learn to practice love, charity, mindful of those who have none, maybe the world will never go hungry. But as we always hear in the news, you know, when there is, for example, a lot of supply with regards to milk, there is there is an oversupply, you know, in order to protect the prices, they would rather throw out the you know, the excess milk rather than give it to and distribute it to those who have none. They would rather throw this milk away, you know, because then so as to protect the prices of the commodity. I think, you know, there is much to go around, really. It's just we are driven more by selfishness, by our lack of regard for those who have none. We're just looking at our own needs, and that is why you know, not everybody gets to share. Not everybody gets filled up. And our Lord's instruction for us really is to take care of one another. And I think personally that is what this story is hinting at to us today. You know, every time we, of course, this gospel has also to do with the Eucharist. And, you know, this morning I celebrated Mass in the school. And it is my custom to always ask the principal, how many children do you have? And how many do you think will be receiving Holy Communion? And they will say to me a number, no, a rough figure. And because I don't like to consecrate a lot of bread, you know, after the school mass, if I go somewhere else, I don't be bringing the Blessed Sacrament with me, you know, to wherever I may be going at that point. But this morning, when I went to celebrate Mass, the teacher says to me, 175. Well, there were more people who were going to receive Holy Communion than 175, you know, and so I ran out of bread to distribute. The other teacher ran out of bread to distribute. But then the principal was still had enough in her bowl, and so I said, half, you know, instead of giving the one whole piece, one whole bread, half it, so let's see, you know, how many can be fed. And then and then there were still eight people, and there were only four halves to receive. And I said, half the other half, you know, make it to, you know, just one fourth. Everybody would have been able to at least get a piece, No? It may not be the whole piece of bread, but at least they got a portion. But I think even in our masses, there's that practical side of things, you know, for the Eucharistic ministers. It should always be that we're looking at how many are going to receive the Eucharist, so that in that way, you know, in that way, everybody gets to participate. Everybody gets to partake of that holy bread, the gift of God to each one of us. Let us all stand. Let us pray for our leaders in the church who suffered dishonor for the sake of the gospel, that they may have the grace to rejoice as the apostles did and keep on proclaiming Jesus as the Lord. We pray to the Lord. For leaders of wealthy nations, that they may not allow the poorer nations to go away hungry, but share their resources for the sake of justice and peace, we pray to the Lord. For vocations, that generous hearts may seek only to dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of their life and to do His work in this world, we pray to the Lord. That we may offer the Lord our small gifts of loaves and fishes, trusting in His power to multiply what we give Him for the sake of all who need compassion and help in their needs, we pray to the Lord. For our beloved departed ones, that they may soon see the bounty of the Lord in the land of the living, we pray to the Lord. In the silence of our hearts, let us include our personal intentions. The Lord is good. The Lord is merciful. Blessed be the name of the Lord, now and forever. Amen.
Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the bread we offer you, fruit of the earth and work of human hands. It will become for us the bread of life. By the mystery of this water and wine, may we come to share in the divinity of Christ, who humbled Himself to share in our humanity. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have this wine we offer you, fruit of the vine and work of human hands. It will become our spiritual drink. Pray, my dear friends, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Accept in compassion, Lord, we pray, the offerings of your family, that under your protective care they may never lose what they have received, but attain the gifts that are eternal through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is a truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, at all times to acclaim you, O Lord, but in this time above all, to laud you yet more gloriously when Christ, our Passover, has been sacrificed. By the oblation of his body, he brought the sacrifices of all to fulfillment in the reality of the cross, and by commending himself to you, for our salvation, showed himself the priest, the altar, and the lamb of sacrifice. Therefore, overcome with paschal joy, every land, every people exults in your praise, and even the heavenly powers with the angelic host sing together the unending hymn of your glory as they acclaim. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take these, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice and, once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take these, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my